Well, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. It is good to be with you this evening and this fine day. It was cool last night, but it turned out to be a beautiful day. Had some sprinkles of rain here and there, and the sun is shining, and the birds are chirping, and we are yet alive one more time in Christ. It is a wonderful time to be in the Lord. It's also a wonderful time to study God's word and to share God's word as we continue along the topic of faith. Faith is the pillar by which we are developing our conversations over the next few months. We'll have topic discussions on faith. But tonight, last week I introduced the topic. I want to have a second part to the introduction, if you will, and dwell a little further into the subject of faith, to make sure that we start off on the right foot, almost like we did and have done with each of the other pillars, fitness, finance, and faith, fitness, finance, and family. And so we wanna ensure that we stay on structure and have a similar approach. And so tonight, again, I'm going to look closely. You remember when we did the financial topics, we started with basic terms, basic terminology, things of that nature. So as we talk about faith again, I want to make sure that we understand what God is saying to us in the way of a biblical definition, if you will, not a precise definition, but a biblical foundation, if you will, of faith as it is laid out, if you will, in the Bible. So that's what we want to do tonight. Let us have a word of prayer and then we can jump right in. I pray that this message reaches beyond your head and into your heart, and that you be able to walk in faith and not by sight. Let us look to the Lord. God, we thank you for the opportunity to share in your word once again, to dwell in it, to meditate on it. God, to just continue to remember that you're speaking to us through your word. So God, in the name of Jesus, we pray that not only are our ears open, but our hearts are open to what you're saying to us tonight. For out of our hearts comes who we are. Out of our hearts comes the identity of who we are. And out of our hearts come the foundation of who we are. So God, shape and mold our hearts tonight through your living word. God, we thank you for, and we appreciate all that's going to be done in this study, in this topical session, God, on faith. Speak now, Lord, as only you can. Send your Holy Ghost to enlighten us, God, to open our mind's eye so that our hearts will pour forth love and light through faith. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen again. I want to go back to where we started last week. We started in the book of Hebrews. And if I'm not mistaken, we looked at chapter Hebrews 11, and we looked at a few verses, but tonight I'm going to focus on the first three verses of Hebrews. I'm going to touch on some of the other verses beyond, but my focus area is on the very first three verses of Hebrews 11, because I think in those three verses are the foundations of faith. Now, Hebrews is a very interesting book, and some say letter, but it is a very interesting treatise, if you will, or letter and book that really talks about faith in a great way, especially here in Hebrews 11. But it's more than that. It is really about how our Christian faith grows out of and is sustained by this conversation between us, the community of believers, the church, and God's word, the Bible. It is this engagement that we have, this conversation and engagement that we have that helps us to have faith. God speaks to us through the word, and from this engagement comes our beliefs. From this engagement comes the ethics, Christian ethics. from this engagement comes the liturgy of the community of believers or the liturgy of the church. From this engagement with God's word comes our purposes or the purposes that God has ordained for not only our lives, for the church itself, different aspects of the church, especially as it's described in the New Testament. And out of it also comes relationships that define our Christian faith. So all of this comes from our meaning the community of believers, the church's engagement with scripture, with the Bible. So all of our faith is grown from scripture as the foundation of the faith. That engagement with the Bible helps to grow our faith. Of course, I've told or taught this before about the Wesleyan quadrilateral, and it begins with faith, and then it has your experience. Scripture, it says, it begins with scripture, I should say, the Bible, basically. Scripture is the foundational element of the quadrilateral. And then from that, we talk about how our experiences help us to develop not only our faith, but our God talk, right? Our theology, our study of God, and that's what we do when we engage the Bible. We're listening to God, we're studying what God is saying to us through the Bible. That's how we're engaging. So you have the scripture, you have your experiences, you have traditions that come about, the traditions like, for example, regardless of what church you are belonging to, maybe different denominations have different traditions. For example, the Baptist Church has certain traditions. The African Methodist Episcopal Church, of which I belong, has different traditions. Of course, the Catholic Church has different traditions. And not only the church traditions, but also traditions that you may have picked up along the way from your family and those in your embedded faith, the faith that's kind of taught to you as a child, or the faith that you're kind of introduced to at a very early age in your core family, preferably in your core family or in those who surround you in your early development. And that grows into your deliberative theology or your deliberative study of God. So scripture, you have your experiences, your life experiences help to also develop your faith, help to develop your God talk. And I'll talk about that some more tonight, your traditions, which I spoke to, and then your reasoning, your reasons or reason, if you will, how you reason with scripture, how you reason with the dynamics of the reality of the world that you live in, and or the physical and the spiritual, let's just say it that way, how you have developed your reason over the years. So these four areas, and in particular, we're focused on scripture tonight and the engagement that we as a community have with scripture. Now, each of us as believers are in this world, but we're not of it. Now, when we're in it, we're gonna have life's experiences. We're going to have the same ups and downs as anyone else. The Bible says it this way, it rains on the just and the unjust. So we're going to have very similar experiences as those who are in the world, but because we're not of the world, we can deal with those experiences differently. How? Through faith, by faith. And we want to talk about that tonight. And that's what these first three verses kind of point out to us that we're going to look at tonight. So we're engaged with the scripture, we're engaged with God's word, and it helps to develop our beliefs, our ethics, our liturgy, our purposes, as well as the relationships that define our Christian faith. Now, generally, Hebrews provides for those who use the lectionary calendar, such as myself. A lectionary lays out the Christ throughout the year. For example, Advent, we just finished Holy Week, right? We just finished in Resurrection Sunday a few weeks back. We had those experiences, but it kind of lays out all of the Christian calendar. And so Hebrews, the book of Hebrews, provides opportunities from the lectionary calendar. And typically when you look at it, and let me just give you an example. Typically when we look at the Advent season, I mentioned Advent and not Lent, but we just came through Lent and then Holy Week and Resurrection Sunday, right? But when you look at the Hebrews and the liturgical calendar, or the lectionary, I should say, it provides opportunities for to engage the text, this book of Hebrews. For example, turn with me to Hebrews 1, and we'll just look at verses 1 through 4. In Hebrews 1, 1 through 4, let me read it for your hearing from the New Living Translation. And it reads this way: long ago, God spoke many times and in many ways to our ancestors through the prophets. Amen. And now in these final days, he has spoken to us through his son. God promised everything to the son as an inheritance. And through the son, he created the universe. The son radiates God's own glory and expresses the very character of God. And he sustains everything by the mighty power of his command. Now, when you look at that Hebrews, that prologue to Hebrews, this verse 1, verses 1 through 4, and then you compare it with the prologue in John's gospel in 1, verse 1 through 14. Let's turn there quickly. John 1, verse 1 through 14. You'll see what I mean by how you use the prologue to Hebrews and this prologue to John's gospel to speak to the Advent season, or the Christmas season, as some call it. And so the Gospel of John 1, verses 1 through 14 reads this way: In the beginning, the Word already existed. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He existed in the beginning with God. God created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. You see the similarities between what Hebrews is saying in 1, as God promised everything to the Son as an inheritance, and through the Son, he created the universe. Let me continue to read. And then it says, the Word gave life to everything that was created, and his life brought light to everyone. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. God sent a man, John the Baptist, to tell all about the light so that everyone might believe because of his testimony. John himself was not the light. He was simply a witness to tell about the light. The one who is the true light, who gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. So that's what John was sent to do. And so then it reads on in verse 10. He came into the very world he created, but the world didn't recognize him. He came to his own people, and even they rejected him. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. They are reborn, not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God. In verse 14, the final verse here, so the Word became human. Some translations said was made flesh. So the Word became human and made his home among us. He was full of unfailing love and faithfulness. Let me say that again. He was full of unfailing love and faithfulness. And we have seen his glory, the glory of the Father's one and only Son. So if you see the prologue of John, the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 1 through 14, and the prologue of Hebrews, you can see how you can utilize those two prologues to sing the praise of Christ during the Advent season or during the Christmas season as Jesus comes into the world. So Hebrews is used in that way. And sometimes it's also used during the two brief periods between Pentecost and Advent. So we're on our way to Pentecost. We've celebrated Resurrection Sunday, and some 50 days later, we know that the Holy Spirit came upon the church, came upon the disciples in the upper room, the church, this was Jesus's promise to the church, right? That the Holy Ghost would be the comforter, the great paraclete would be with us. And so here we are examining faith from Hebrews and recognizing that Hebrews is a very important book in the Bible, not beyond the Gospels, I'll say it that way, because Hebrews is it's one of the finest examples of homiletic rhetoric available to us from the first century, as it provides the most elaborate Christian readings of the Old Testament to be found in the New Testament. That's what Hebrews is. Hebrews is called the word of exaltation. It says that in Hebrews 13:22. Let me turn there right quick, and then I'm gonna get back to our focus text. 13:22 reads this way, that is a word of exaltation. And so you hear, it says this way in 13:22, I urge you, dear brothers and sisters, to pay attention to what I have written in this brief exhortation, referring to the book of Hebrews. This is near the end of the book, all right? And so it is called the book of exhortation. And so what does that mean? What does it mean when we say the book of exhortation? So here it is, let me explain this. From the dictionary, you'll find this address or this definition for exhortation: an address or communication emphatically urging someone to do something. Now, what does it mean biblically for us, this exhortation? The term exhortation is usually interpreted as pure advising. However, the meaning of exhortation extends beyond that. Let's take a look at several translations. In the Greek, the term exhortation is called parakletio, or comforter. Remember the great, I mentioned the Holy Spirit being the great paraclete, right? A similar word with the Holy Spirit, a comforter. Now, what we need to understand is this term parakletio, or paraklesis, is the same term used for encouragement. So not only is the book of Hebrews exalting us to believe, it is encouraging us to believe. Let me explain that. So encouragement in from the Greek means that it's from the same exact word, parakletio, right? Or paraklesis, meaning beside, near, alongside. And kleo means to call or summon. And so a paraclete is someone called alongside another to counsel, encourage, to help, and bring comfort. We call on the great paraclete. We call on the Holy Spirit to walk beside us, to walk alongside us, to be near us, to be with us, living and breathing in us, to encourage us, to counsel us, to help us, and to bring us comfort in the time of need. Isn't this what Jesus promised to us? This is what Jesus promised to us. Okay, so you have an idea. This is what Hebrews does for us to encourage our faith, to exalt us towards faith. This is what the writer of Hebrews is saying in 13:22 when he tells although the audience is not necessarily addressed in the letter or the book, it says in 13:22, I urge you, dear brothers and sisters, to pay attention to what I have written in this book, in this brief exhortation. Pay attention, pay attention. So this book is meant to encourage, this book is meant to exalt us towards the faith that we have in God. Okay. And it is with this understanding that we look at the focus text in 11, verses 1-3. And so that it reads this way in the New Living Translation. Listen, this is the starting point of it with the definition again. Faith is the confidence. Let me say that again. Faith is the confidence that what we hope for will actually happen. It gives us assurance. Say that again. It gives us assurance about things we cannot see. That is the biblical definition, if you will, or the biblical foundation of faith. And so it was by faith that Jesus left or provided the Great Commission, laying it into the hands of the disciples. We are disciples of Christ. I want you to know that as well, and you should know that. But it is by faith that the disciples also receive the Great Commission. What are you talking about, preacher? The Great Commission as given to the disciples in Matthew. If you look at it in Matthew's gospel, and I'm doing this with emphasis and point for you. In Matthew 28, 16, this is how 16, 17, and right on through 20. Let's read it. And this is how it reads in Matthew 28, 16 through 20. And this is the New Living Translation. Then the 11 disciples left for Galilee, going to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some of them doubted. Keep a pen in that. Jesus came and told his disciples, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations. Or in some translations, it reads, make disciples of all people. Here's the key, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples. So not only are you going and making disciples of all people, you're baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and you're teaching these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. These are the commands that Jesus has given. One of the most important, love the Lord your God with all your everything, your heart, your mind, your soul, your strength. Likewise, love one another. This was a great command that Jesus gave us. And be sure of this, I am with you even to the end of the age. Some translations say, even unto the end of the earth. So this is the Great Commission. Now keep in mind, Jesus entrusts these disciples who are worshiping him and wavering in their faith. Some of them are wavering in their faith because they're doubting. So some are worshiping, some are doubting today. Some of us are worshiping, operating in faith, and some of us are still wavering. Some of us are still doubting. It's no knock. We've all doubted. We've all had our moments of doubt. We've all wavered from time to time in the faith. But we're called to be disciples of Christ, to follow the Christ. And this is what we're called to do, the Great Commission, to make disciples of all people. To make disciples of all nations, baptizing them, teaching them the commands. And here's the important part. Jesus has promised to be with us always. God has promised to be with us always, never leaving or forsaking us. Even when you should go through that valley of the shadow of death situation, God promises to be with you, to be a rod and a staff in the midst of what you're going through. to guide you, to prop you up on every leaning side, the staff, and a rod to beat back the enemy. Amen, somebody, amen. Back to Hebrews 11, I read the definition. And then it says this way, through their faith. Did you hear what I said? This is verse 2, 11 verse 2, New Living Translation. Through their faith, the people in the days of old earned a good reputation. So what does that say to us? Not only are we to have a confident assurance, but we are also to operate through our faith, and it gives us a reputation. Or in some translations, it says a good report. Now let me back up. The foundational principle of a confident assurance, that's what we're basically talking about, a confident assurance. A confident assurance that says to us that even though we can't see it, that God will make it happen. It will actually happen for us. But what we hope for will actually happen. It gives us assurance about the things we can't. We can't see it, but God can. So when you look at the definition of faith, it's not so much about us. It's really about the faithfulness of God. It's really about us having faith in God. It's really about God's faithfulness that we have this confident assurance in. But what we come to understand, remember I talked about scripture being a part of our finance, our foundation of our understanding and study of God, our God talk. And then I talked about the experiences, right? So as we have our experiences with God, as we walk this earth and have the human experience, even though we're spiritual beings having this human experience, we come to know God through these experiences. We come to understand how God moves us through our faith. God moves through our faith and blesses us through our faith, as it's saying here in verse 2. So that definition, that foundation is based on us believing for God's faithfulness. It's based on us believing God. Remember the very first thing I talked about was the prelude to Hebrews as well as John. But here it is again, so we understand. We are believing in a God that continues to speak to us and spoke in the days of old through to our ancestors, through prophets. We're believing in faith and confident assurance that the same God sent his only begotten Son to speak to us in the final days, and that God promised his Son everything and an inheritance. What's the inheritance that God promised? Us. We are the inheritance that God promised his Son. And through the Son, he created the universe. So we're believing in the God who created everything that we see. Even though we see it now because God commanded it, we wouldn't have known it because we wouldn't have been able to see it. But our faith tells us that God created it. And that goes really beyond the reputation and report. And it goes to the last verse that I'm gonna really speak to. And that's by faith. By faith, we understand. This is verse 3, Hebrews 11, verse 3. By faith, we understand that the entire universe was formed at God's command. That what we now see did not come from anything that could be seen. So you see how that intertwines with our faith. By God's word and command, everything that was not seen came into existence. God said, commanded, let there be light, and there was light. There was nothing before that. It was darkness and void. God said, let there be light, and light came. Amen, somebody. This is the Genesis story, right? This is the creation story. And so we see that at God's command, and this is talking about, it says by faith those things came into being at God's command. It's not talking about God, because God is faithful, but it's talking about the word of God. By faith, we understand that the God that we have faith in created everything. Hallelujah, somebody. You ought to be excited about that. The God that we believe in created. So in order to have to move through faith, in order to move by faith, you must believe in the God who created everything. You must believe not only in the God that created everything, but you also must believe, as it says in the prologue to Hebrews, in his son, that God promised everything to the son as an inheritance. You must believe that you are the inheritance of the son, and that because the son came, because Jesus came, because the word came, as it says in John, because the word came, because in the beginning the word was already existing. You must believe that the word was with God. You must believe that the word was God. That's what you have to believe. This is the foundation of our faith. That word existed in the beginning with God, was God, and God created everything through him, including you and I. And nothing was created except through him. The word gave life to everything that was created. That's you and I and everything else. We have life because of Jesus. We have life because of the living word. We have life because God promised his son this inheritance. And so through the son, he created the universe, everything that we now see. And as it says in 11:3, that by faith, we understand that the entire universe was formed at God's command. It's our faith that helps us to understand the creation story, that God is a creator. It's our faith that helps us to understand that he sent his only begotten son so that we would be an inheritance, that we would be restored, renewed, and reconciled back into God the Father. So it is impossible to please God without faith. That's why the Bible says it that way. You can't operate through faith or by faith and understand the biblical principle of faith, the foundational principle of faith, this confident assurance that we have, without having faith in the one who is faithful, the creator, the sustainer of our lives, the one who gives us life and life more abundant, the one who created us and gives us eternal life when we have faith, when we believe in and on the name of Jesus. Not only do we confess it with our mouth, we believe it in our heart of hearts. Don't you know how important that is? That's faith. That's faith. That's faith. And so here it is. Here it is. So we have this biblical foundation of faith. We have this statement about through faith. Let me read that again. Through faith, we get a good report. I'm going to explain that. But I want to go back to the point of being disciples of Christ and understanding that it was Jesus giving us this commission. And even though we worship and wavered in faith, we are given this responsibility to continue to make disciples of all people, of all nations, baptizing them and teaching them the commands. Amen. Jesus' commandments to us, to the church. Amen. So what I'm saying there, and what we need to understand, is through our faith, we get this report. Through our faith, we get this reputation, as it says in verse 2. Just like these brothers and sisters, by the way, they were there too. It mentioned the disciples the male disciples by name as apostles. But remember, the sisters were there too. They were following Christ as well. And they were disciples as well. And so they believed God. and moved ahead, even though they wavered in faith, some of them, just like us. Some of us are wavering in our faith. Some of us are worshiping and wavering. Now, let me explain what I mean by wavering. When I say doubt, I don't mean doubt from the standpoint of they doubted God. What I mean by doubt is, and we have this sometimes, where we will have multiple avenues, multiple choices, and they all seem good to us. And so we doubt, we don't know which one to take. But by faith, we believe that God orders our steps to the right path. Amen, somebody? So that's what I mean. But they were wavering, they were doubting, they didn't know what to believe in this case, and then they were given this great commission. We have this great commission. We have this great work ahead of us by faith. By faith. And even with little faith, don't you remember the story of the disciples? After Jesus is teaching the people in parables, he tells them, he's teaching from the boat. He's getting into the boat and going to the other side. He's resting in the aft part of the boat and on a pillow, the rear part of the boat on a pillow, sleeping. And a storm comes up, a violent storm comes up. And do you remember what Jesus says to the disciples when they were of? He says it this way. O ye of little faith, and one translation it says, why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith? But another translation it says, O ye of little faith. And so even the little faith, even the little wavering faith that we have from time to time, the faith the size of a mustard seed, for example, is more than enough for God to do great things through the faith that we have. It's through the faith that we have in the God of all creation that signs, wonders, and miracles take place. It is through our faith that we get this reputation. Through our faith, we get this good report. Through the faith in the one who is faithful to see, help us see, and to help us have a confident assurance that what we hope for and cannot see, that he'll give it to us, that God will give it to us. Listen, God will keep his word. God is not a man that he should lie, the Bible says. And God promises us. In the Bible, God makes over 7,400 promises to us. And God is faithful to fulfill each one of his promises. So our faith is based on God's faithfulness. And when we have this faith, we can trust God. When we have this faith, we can believe God. When we have this faith, even though we waver, and even though it may be little faith, God can do the miraculous. The psalmist says it this way, great is thy faithfulness, God. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. That's why we have a confident assurance, because God is faithful. When we've experienced God throughout our lives, we come to understand that God is faithful. I don't know about you, but I've had some times when I've had to call on the name of Jesus. I've had some instances in my life's experiences where I've had to call on the name of Jesus. And God, heal my body. I remember my call story. You probably heard it before. I was 11 years old, sick on a headboat, a fishing boat, and had this experience with God. And God healed my body. I couldn't tell you how long I had this experience. All I know is that I was encompassed in God. I was praying because I was so sick. And God showed up. And God showed up, and I was encompassed in God's voice, in God's presence, and it healed my body. And it also served as my call story. It called me to ministry. Within a month, within 2 months, I was in a hospital bed. I had an appendectomy and I had double hernia surgery. I left the hospital in a wheelchair. I'm 11 years old and I'm in a wheelchair, can't walk. And God had already healed my body from the sickness, seasickness, and called me to preach. I didn't know it at the time what the calling was. I learned that later in life, continuing to walk with God. But all I know is that as soon as that happened, within 2 months, the enemy attacked my body, and I'm in a wheelchair leaving the hospital. I pray to God again. I know I've had this experience with God. I had it, and it was so overwhelming that when I was healed, I ran to the around the boat and told everybody about this experience. I evangelized like that woman did at the well about Jesus. I evangelized about God healing my body. I was sick, and then all of a sudden I was well. So I evangelized. So I had that experience to know that God could heal me. And so I pray to God, and I go through the process of healing. But God healed my body, allowed me to run on, first walk, almost to a crawl, walk, and then run on to see what the end. Here I am, some 50 years later now, still running on for God, still running on for Christ, and believing through my experiences, knowing through my experiences, by faith, that I serve a God who's faithful to heal my body. You may have had experiences like this. You may have had very similar experiences. You may have had, I don't know, it may have been sickness. It may have been before a judge. It may have been traffic court. It may have been a marriage that was going through where you've had to go through some things, and by faith, God brought you through. By faith, you're still clothed in your right mind. By faith, you were able to keep on running on to see what the end would be. And your faith increased. And because you moved through faith and by faith, you have your report. Your life is one of a good report. Listen, when we move through our faith, it provides this good report, reputation. Like it says in verse 2. Now I want you to realize something. It is because of our faith journey. And so Hebrews 11 talks about by faith, the everything that was created, that could not be seen can now be seen by faith, by God's command, right? And so we have faith that God commanded it, and we believe in the God of creation, not only the God of creation, but the God who sustains us, who sends his only begotten son to reconcile us, making us inheritors, and to be a part of God's family. To be children of light, be children of the Most High God. That's important. We're born again, and we have relationship through faith to a faithful God. And now through our faith, it says the people of old earned a good reputation. These are those who, by examples of faith, are listed throughout the 11th chapter of Hebrews. I think that they're listed throughout the 11th chapter of Hebrews. And it's because of their faith journey that we know their report, their lives far beyond their natural lives, because they tasted death without receiving all that God had promised them, as it says in 11:39. Hebrews 11:39, turn with me. This is the last verse, or next to the last verse in Hebrews 11. All of these people earn a good reputation because of their faith. Yet none of them received all that God had promised. They had a taste of it. They got a taste. You and I are getting a foretaste, a taste of what it will mean to be in, to be a part of the kingdom of heaven, where God lives amongst us. We're getting a taste, a foretaste of it. And we get that as God provides for us through his faithfulness, as God answers these 7,400 plus promises, fulfills them in our lives. And through our faith, because we're believing God, and through faith, we continue to believe God, and through faith, we continue to grow in God, and through faith, we continue to mature in Christ. Through faith, we receive a good report. Now, our lives would be nothing without faith. Our lives are defined through our faith and God's faithful response to our faith. That's what the dash means between the time you're born and the time you leave this earth. In physical death, that dash is the report. That dash is the report. Through faith, that's how you'll be remembered. That dash is the reputation that you'll be remembered by. He or she was a person of faith. When what will your dash say when you're eulogized? Don't you know we're preachers and pastors and have to preach the eulogy, the bereavement services. We preach from the dash. The dash is the report. The dash is the reputation. And by faith, we preach how you moved and lived your life through and by faith. The goodness of the Lord shown through your faith and God's faithfulness to you throughout your life. That's the through faith. The by faith, we understand that the entire universe was formed. That's believing in the God of creation. That's the foundation of our faith. It starts with believing in a God that's faithful, believing in the God that created everything, created the universe, as it says. By faith statements, here in verse 3, there are 18 by faith statements that follow verse 3. By faith, and you see it, in very first one, by faith, we understand the entire universe was formed by God, at God's command, and then you see the next one, it was by faith that Abel brought a more acceptable offering to God than Cain did. Abel's offering gave evidence, it was his offering that gave evidence that he was a righteous man. It was his offering that gave evidence that he was a righteous man. Nothing else, we're knowing nothing else about Abel, but his reputation and report by faith of his offering that he brought to God. That's what we know. And Abel's long dead because Cain killed him. You remember that, right? Cain killed his brother Abel. But we remember his example of faith by his offering. His example of faith still speaks to us because of his offering. That's his example. That's his report. That's his reputation is based on the offering. Same thing with Enoch. By faith, Enoch was taken up into heaven without dying. He disappeared. He was taken up without dying, to heaven without dying, because God took him. And so it was by faith. That's his reputation. We remember Enoch by his faith that he didn't die a natural death or a physical death. He was taken up into heaven. By faith, Noah built a large boat to save his family from the flood. Why? Because by faith he obeyed God. Just as Enoch and Abel did. He obeyed God. He obeyed God and built a boat, even though it had never rained before, even though waters had never sprung from the earth the way that they did during the flood. But nevertheless, and don't you know that it was years? It was almost 120 years, if I'm not mistaken, that before it even happened, before the flood event. So all the time, Noah, by faith, is obeying God and building this large boat, the ark, as we call it, to save not only his family, but creation, those things that God had created. By faith, statements prove just how powerful God's word is. By God's command, everything that we now see came from nothing, including you and I. And by faith, we have these reputations or reports of these 18 or so individuals. By faith, from Abel to Abraham, from Abraham to Jacob, Esau, and Joseph, and from Moses on down to Rahab. Amen, somebody. To Rahab. And so all of these, I remember, think about that. Rahab is remembered by her faith. She's not remembered based on her former life, which all of us have some flaws. All of us have some personality traits. All of us have some, as Myers-Briggs would call it, personality traits that make us up. All of us have some flaws, some shortcomings. Most of us have some shortcomings. I know you're perfect. I know some of you are perfect and don't have any shortcomings. But we have these personalities. We have these personality traits. We have these shortcomings. Rahab had some personality. Moses had some personality traits and shortcomings. Remember, Moses didn't He didn't accept God's call upon his life to go free the children of Egypt. He initially, because he stuttered, he initially said he couldn't do it. As a matter of fact, he said he couldn't do it, and the only way he would be able to do it if he sent his brother with him, Aaron. You remember, he had some personality flaws. He had some traits. He had, like those disciples that we read about, that like us that have the Great Commission, had some wavering faith. He had some personality flaws, and these personality flaws, in spite of the personality flaw, all it took was the faith the size of a mustard seed. And with that faith, God did mighty signs and wonders through Moses. Rahab, likewise, she's remembered and has a good report because of her faith. By faith, Rahab, the prostitute, was not destroyed with the people in her city who refused to obey God, for she had given a friendly welcome to the spies in verse 31, 11, 31. She's remembered by faith. What will you be remembered by? What will your dad say? What will your report be? What will your reputation be? What will your by faith story be on the day that you're called home, preferably to be with the Lord, when you're absent from this body and present before God? What will your report say? By faith, through faith, and by faith, we are constantly moving through faith and by faith. And our life's experiences are helping us, and we're going through the life experiences as we move through faith and by faith. And as we move through faith and by faith, we're socializing and engaging our traditions, the traditions, and we vet those out as we in our deliberative faith, as we grow from the embedded faith, which we get as children, as young people. And we move from that embedded faith to our more deliberative faith, where we're starting to decide for ourselves through our experiences, through the traditions that we come to know. And then as we reason in our minds and in our hearts, we grow in faith. We grow in faith through these experiences. And all of this is tempered by our engagement with the scriptures. Our engagement with the scriptures. I'll go back to where we started, and then we'll understand, and we'll close for the evening. Our engagement with the scriptures, this is what it says to us. Our engagement with the scriptures causes us to grow in faith. That's what it says. We grow in faith because we are exalted and encouraged by the word of God, by the scriptures. We grow in faith. We grow in faith as a result of this engagement that we have with the scriptures. And so the book of Hebrews provides this wonderful opportunity to engage. It gives us this wonderful opportunity to develop our beliefs. It gives us this wonderful opportunity to develop our Christian ethics. There's a whole school of thought and classes in a seminary around Christian ethics. And so we need more of that in this day and age, because people are literally making up their own ethics as they go, I believe. And so the engagement with the scripture, as we're experiencing, as we're going through tradition, as we're reasoning, helps us to develop our faith, helps us to develop our beliefs, helps us to develop our Christian ethics, helps us to understand the Christian liturgy, if you will, and the purposes by which God is speaking to and through his word. And then not only that, the relationships of the church, the relationships of the different aspects of the church, the relationships that we're to have with one another, even the relationships that we're to have with our enemies. Don't you remember the command? Love one another. Love even your enemies. Amen. And to walk, to be the salt of the earth and to be the light of the world. Have flavor and also shine the light of Christ, because you are faith, you're believing in faith to the one who is faithful, to the one who is faithful. I want to encourage you to study this text, even the first through the book of Hebrews, in particular Hebrews 11, closely. As you grow in faith, I want to encourage you to engage the scriptures. I had a course, or was it a summit? There was a summit, a leadership summit I attended, a Christian leadership summit I attended. And one of the sessions, I was shocked to find that the research shows that, I hate to even say it, about 90% of the people who attend church don't read their Bibles regularly. How can you grow in faith if you're not engaging the text, if you're not engaging the scripture? You understand, or should understand from tonight's session, how important engagement, the church, you are part of the church, you are the part of the community of believers, how important that engagement is to your faith, how important that engagement is to your purpose, how important that engagement to your understanding of Christian ethics, if you will, how important this is to your relationships, your Christian relationships, your marriage, for example. The Word of God is important for your marriage. If you're not reading it, then I'm not sure. It's going to give you guidance. It's going to instruct you. It's going to show you, both husband and wife, how you should love one another, how you should respect one another, how you should grow together as one in faith. In faith. That's where we have to stop tonight. I pray that this teaching has been a blessing to you. I'm praying next week that we'll have a guest to talk more around the subject of faith. It won't be this in depth as far as the Word. It'll probably be more experiential. Have someone talk about their faith experiences, and then we'll come back and see how that does as we continue along this pillar, this session pillar of faith, and continue along right on through late June or early July. God bless you. I pray that you had a wonderful experience tonight. Let us close with a word of prayer. God, we thank you for your Word. We thank you, God, that you engage us through your Word and you continue to speak to us through your Word. God, your Word is alive. This is living Word that guides us, that shows us, and continually transforms our minds and our hearts. God, we pray that as we engage your session tonight, as we pray, engage what you share with us tonight, that we will be blessed and continue to study and meditate on your Word. That's why you tell us to meditate on your Word both day and night, because it's important to our faith. It's important to our understanding of what you're saying to us. It's important to our purpose. It's important to our ethics. It's important to our relationships. God, we thank you for being a God who is faithful, a God who gives us promises and able to fulfill each and every one of them. God, we thank you for your Word. Now, God, in the name of Jesus, we pray that at least one person tonight, if not more, will be transformed through this Word, transformed through this session, transformed through this teaching. God, that they might, that all who would hear this might engage the Word on a daily basis, daily, and that they might thirst for your Word, they may hunger for your Word, just as they do as you give them daily bread, life each and every day. Now, God, in the name of Jesus, do it. And we'll be careful to give your name all of the praise, honor, and glory so richly deserved. For you are God and God alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen again. God bless you. Have a wonderful night. We pray we'll see you next week.